Good morning. It's a privilege to be here. My name is Mark Slonim. I've been involved in both U.S. v. Michigan and in the Mille Lacs litigation, later stages of U.S. v. Michigan than Bruce. I wanted to try to provide a little context for the treaty right and how it kind of originated as a major force in Indian country and what it means today. The cases we've been discussing, U.S. v. Michigan, the Voight case, and the Mille Lacs case, involved three different treaties. A treaty in Michigan negotiated in 1836, a treaty in Wisconsin and part of what's now Minnesota in 1837, and then another treaty in Wisconsin and Michigan in 1842. All of those treaties involved Indians ceding lands that they held to the United States at a time when the United States wasn't really interested in the lands for purposes of American settlement, which was the case in many Indian treaties in areas further south and further east. The real goal of the United States in those treaties was to acquire natural resources, either timber or minerals or other resources that were available on land. The lands were far enough north and considered sufficiently inhospitable to American farming and agriculture that settlement wasn't really the driving force behind the treaties. Resources and acquisition and control of resources was what was at stake. From the Indian perspective, Indian people were willing to share resources as long as they could remain on the land and continue a way of life that centered on hunting, fishing, trapping, and gathering. And so every one of those treaties has a provision which preserves to the Indians the rights to remain and to hunt, fish, trap, and gather. The rights were conditioned in different ways in each treaty. In the 1836 treaty in Michigan, the right continued until the lands were required for settlement. In the 1837 treaty in Wisconsin and Minnesota, the right was preserved during the pleasure of the president. In the 1842 treaty, the right was preserved until the Indians were ordered to remove. But despite those conditions, it was clear, if you look at the negotiating history of these treaties, that the central condition of the Indian land cession was the ability to remain on the land and continue to utilize resources that had sustained them for thousands of years. And that actually worked very well in the years after the treaties were enacted. Indian peoples remained on the land. As American industry advanced and American resource extraction took place, Indians often worked in the mines, harvested the timber, and traded with non-Indian communities that were moving in, providing fish and wildlife to them for their subsistence, and were able to continue their own way of life at the same time. What changed beginning in the latter part of the 1800s came with the railroads. And with the railroads came the ability for non-Indians to commercially harvest fish and game and ship them to markets in the east. And that led to the decimation of many fish and game populations. And as states observed this, they began to step in and said, we have to do something about this. And the first step was to ban commercial harvest. And then as the sport fishing and sport hunting ethos developed among non-Indians, states began to develop regulations that didn't just try to preserve resources from decimation, but started allocating resources to sports hunters and sports fishers. And so you ended up with hunting seasons that lasted 2 weeks in the fall, which worked perfectly for urban elites who were interested in leaving the cities and going out and hunting for a couple of weeks. But it didn't work so well for subsistence hunters, Indians or non-Indians, who couldn't confine eating to 2 weeks a year. Who needed to hunt and fish the rest of the year. And as these sports regulations developed further, the idea that it was unsporting to take fish with a net or a spear developed, and only certain kinds of fishing were okay. And that further disadvantaged Indian people. And Indian people objected. As states developed enforcement capabilities, started enforcing these laws, it wasn't lawyers who said, wait a second, there's Indian treaty rights. It was Indian people who said, we have treaty rights. You can't tell us not to harvest resources.